Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
All right, Psalm 32, if you're there, say hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may need to say hallelujah again. Hallelujah. Or, as one preacher told me, praise-a-lujah, hallelujah. That's when you get your tongue tangled. Right? Praise God. Here we go. A couple things I really liked this past week. I have a great need for Christ, but I have a great Christ for my need. Can you testify to that? Our country desperately needs CPR. Everybody say CPR. Christ, repentance, prayer, and repentance. We need it. Amen. This blessed me today. Bringing down the walls of Jericho involved more walking than shouting. A Sunday shout is great, but it can't replace a daily walk. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. How about this? When Job had everything, he worshiped. When he lost everything, he worshiped. Worship isn't about your circumstance. It's about who God is. Worship anyway. Amen. And this made me laugh. Me yelling, representative, to the automated customer service. Has anybody done that? I know you have. Press 1 for English, 2 for Spanish. And go out to check the mail in Alabama lately. It's been pretty hot, but I think a cold front's coming our way, hopefully. Amen. Here's what I want to talk about tonight, the freedom of forgiveness. The freedom of forgiveness. Psalm 32, we'll read in just a moment. Forgiveness gives us freedom from guilt and condemnation and breaks down any barriers between us and God. How many glad you've experienced the freedom of forgiveness? My dad had a bumper sticker. He was a businessman, and he would lease cars, and he'd switch over every 2 or 3 years. But he always had the same bumper sticker from the time I was a kid until not long ago. Every vehicle he had the same bumper sticker. Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven. How many glad you've been forgiven? We're going to find out exactly what that means tonight. All right, so we're in Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to put it on the screen. The other verses we'll read in a moment. Will you read it out loud with me? This is the New King James Version, by the way. It says, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit." The King James says guile. All right, so notice that twice, blessed. Verse 1 starts with blessed. Verse 2 starts with blessed or blessed. We sang about it. How many testify and say, I'm blessed? We say that a lot. Do we understand what we mean? Here's what it means. Having spiritual well-being and prosperity. I like that definition. Look at these definitions. Supremely happy. Anybody supremely happy? Fortunate. Highly favored. Spiritually prosperous. Well spoken of and enriched with benefits. Now, how many will say, I'm blessed? Yes, I'm blessed. too blessed to be stressed, too blessed to be oppressed, too blessed to be depressed. Hallelujah. I'm blessed in Jesus' name. Praise God. Now, I want you to notice something about Psalm 32. It's a companion psalm to Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is David's psalm of repentance. Psalm 32 is a psalm of forgiveness. In fact, you could consider Psalm 32 to be the forgiveness chapter of the Bible. Just like 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter of the Bible. Just like Hebrews 11 is the faith chapter of the Bible. This is the forgiveness chapter of the Bible. But notice this, both psalms share the same context. The aftermath of David's adulterous affair with Bathsheba and the subsequent cover-up, the murder of her husband, Uriah the Hittite. All right, for the duration of Bathsheba's pregnancy, David lived with unconfessed sin. He described the emotional and spiritual anguish of living under this burden in poetic words. I want you to look at the next few words or verses in your Bible. You see verse 3. He says, when I kept silence. What does that mean, when I kept silence? Meaning, he lived with unconfessed sin. He was trying to hide it from God. He was trying to bury it, pretend nothing was wrong. I mean, oh, that doesn't last very, very good. When I kept silence, listen to these poetic words. My bones grew old through my groaning or roaring all the day long. Verse 4, for day and night your hand was heavy on me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer, Selah. In other words, he's saying, the hounds of heaven were after me and I was miserable. How many have ever been there? You ever been there where God was dealing with you, convicting you about something, and you just couldn't get peace, you just couldn't feel right? Because you knew there was a barrier between you and God. Listen, the Holy Spirit will not allow born-again, Spirit-filled believers to enjoy sin. No, I know there's pleasure in sin for a season. And you may indulge in the flesh and think you're having a good time, but what happens when you lay down at night and you think about it? The guilt, the condemnation, the burden, that barrier between you and God. You can't enjoy it. You got to repent. You've got to get right. You say, that's a terrible thing. No, that's your greatest friend. There are people out here who can steal and they can murder and they can rape and they can commit all kinds of evil and crime and not feel a twinge of guilt. They've seared their conscience. Maybe some of them have been turned over to a reprobate mind, but you just say an ugly word and the hounds of heaven are nipping at your heels. You just have a bad attitude and the Holy Spirit just melts you down. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you deal with me. Thank you, Lord, that you draw me. Thank you, Lord, that you don't let me drift far from you. Hallelujah. Conviction is your best friend. Keeps you on that straight and narrow way. Well, David lived for 8 or 9 months. We're not exactly sure how long the duration of Bathsheba's pregnancy, with God's hand being heavy on him. He knew he wasn't right. It's a miserable place to be. To you. Confess and repent, and then God lifts that weight, that burden. Hallelujah. All of this could have been avoided if David had immediately repented. Eventually, you know the story. David lived with this unconfessed sin. He was miserable for months, and then you remember what happens. God sent Nathan the prophet to confront him with a heart-piercing parable that drove him to repentance. You remember the story? Nathan appealed to that shepherd, that inner shepherd in David, told him a story. Said there was a rich man who had flocks and herds. There was a poor man who had one lamb. The rich man had a visitor. A guest showed up at his house. And instead of slaying one of his flocks, he took his neighbor, the poor man's only lamb. And David got furious. That indignation rose up in him. Not only was he a shepherd, he knew about this. He said he ought to repay it fourfold, and not only that, he ought to be killed. Be careful about pointing those fingers at other people, because there's three pointing right back at us. And Nathan said, "Thou art the man." Hit him right between the eyes. Then he hit his knees. Then he confessed. Then he repented. And then he wrote this glorious psalm, Psalm 32, that we're reading tonight. As dire consequence of his sin mounted, the broken psalmist repented. He received forgiveness, and he expressed his gratitude for God's mercy right here for us to read. Now, let's take a moment. To really understand forgiveness, we need to understand sin, right? Because that's what we're forgiven of. Notice, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. What is transgression? Here's what the word, I did a little word study on this. It means to revolt, to break away from just authority. Listen, my friend, rebellion is the spirit of Satan. He rebelled against God in the beginning. There's an old rock and roll song. I don't know many of them, but I heard it somewhere down the road in the 80s. Turn me loose, turn me loose. I got to do it my way or no way at all. Well, that's the spirit of rebellion. The Bible says the spirit of rebellion is as the sin of what? Witchcraft, right? Here's something else. There's a related word to transgression, that is trespass. It means to cross over a boundary. God has established boundaries in his word for moral behavior, for righteous conduct. And whenever we step over those boundaries, it constitutes sin and necessitates forgiveness. All right? You've heard this before, I'm sure. There's a word, a Hebrew word, cheda, which means missing the mark. It's translated sin in the Bible, because that's what sin is. It's whenever we miss God's mark. What is God's mark? Perfection. How many say, "I missed the mark"? Yeah, the Hebrew archers, they'd pull an arrow out and they'd shoot that bow, aiming for the bullseye, the target. But whenever they'd miss, they would say cheda, which means missing the mark. And somehow that word somehow got translated into sin. That's what sin is, missing God's mark. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You say, "Oh, you don't know about my grandma. She was the holiest, most sanctified, righteous woman you've ever met." Yeah, you didn't know her when she was young and wild as a buck. Love you. Bible says there is none righteous. No, not one. Hallelujah. Our righteousness is filthy rags. That's why we've got to have his righteousness, which is by faith. How many say, "I've missed the mark"? I've missed the mark many times. That's why I need Jesus. Hallelujah. So when you understand sin, then you can understand forgiveness. Sin is crossing over boundaries. All right. God has established boundaries in his word. Whenever we cross over those boundaries, constitutes sin, necessitates forgiveness. Brother Mike has told a funny story for years about his son. His son was, I don't know, a toddler at that time, and he kept straying out of their yard in their little subdivision. And he didn't want to get out in the street and get run over. He didn't want to get over in the neighbor's yard and maybe get bit by a dog or something. So he's trying to keep him in the yard. But he'd keep wandering off. How many know all we like sheep have gone astray? We've turned everyone to his own way, right? All right. So Brother Mike, he put some sticks in his yard. You know, he's got the driveway. You got the sidewalk. Well, this side, there was no barrier between their yard and the neighbor's yard. So he got a long stick and he laid it right there. And he said, "Son, don't go past the stick." Sure enough, he was playing around. Brother Mike's working, you know, doing something in the yard. A few minutes later, he looked and his son had picked up the stick. Made him a new boundary. He didn't go past the stick. But that's the problem. God has put the boundary in his word, and what does man do? He keeps moving the boundary. He keeps moving the boundary. "Oh, I'm fine. Look, look." Why? Because we've moved the boundary. We're not in God's boundary. We've made up our own boundary. Oh, I'm preaching tonight. Hallelujah. So to trespass means to cross over a boundary. What did Jesus say? Forgive us our trespasses whenever we go across a boundary, even as we forgive those who trespass against us. You get anything out of this? All right, now this all looks happy, doesn't it? David and Bathsheba and little Solomon right there. Looks like a happy little family, doesn't it? Doesn't tell the whole story. I'm glad the Bible does. You see, David unfortunately crossed over three of God's boundaries. Number one, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. Number two, thou shalt not commit adultery. Number three, thou shalt not murder. Three of God's boundaries David crossed over. For these sins, David repented and received forgiveness. But it should be noted that forgiveness does not automatically remove the consequences that necessarily follow sinful conduct. If we sow to the flesh, what happens? We'll reap corruption. Forgiveness, yes. Forgiveness happens in an instant. But restoration is a process. There's no doubt in my mind, you could have a serial killer on death row. If that man genuinely repents of his sin, confesses his sin, asks Jesus into his heart, I believe he can be washed in the blood of Jesus. I believe he can be saved, redeemed, born again, sanctified, and on his way to heaven. Just like the thief on the cross. Does that mean you let him out of jail? There's something called you reap what you sow. And forgiveness does not always negate the consequence of sin. Too many people sow wild oats all week long and come to church on Sunday and pray for crop failure. How many know it don't work that way? Galatians 6, 7, and 8. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. So let's talk about David's dysfunctional family for a minute. Look at somebody say, you think your family has problems? Go ahead, tell them. You think your family has problems? David didn't get away with anything. He had a terrible price that he paid for his sin. Nathan the prophet prophesied that even though God forgave David as a result of his sin, he said, the sword shall never depart from your home, and God will raise up adversity against you from your own house. Internal strife and turmoil erupted in the palace. Listen to this. Consider the far-reaching repercussions that ravaged the royal family long after King David was forgiven. David and Bathsheba's illegitimate child died 7 days after it was born. Tamar, who was David's daughter, was raped by one of his sons named Amnon. Amnon, in turn, was murdered by his half-brother Absalom in revenge for violating Tamar. This is all in the Bible. It's all in 2 Samuel. Absalom later plotted a coup against his own father's throne, and David had to flee into exile from his own son, from his own palace for several months. He's forgiven, but that doesn't erase all the consequences that are set in motion. Absalom, fulfilling Nathan's prophecy, committed fornication with 10 of David's concubines on the palace rooftop. It's in the Bible, folks. I'm not making this up. Absalom, against David's wishes, was killed on the battlefield. God promised the sword would never depart from his kingdom, thus forever tarnishing his legacy as a man of bloodshed and precluded him from building the temple. David wanted to build God a temple. He said, it's not right for me to live in a house of cedar, and God's ark out there is in curtains. And that was his desire. And the prophet Nathan said, no, you're not going to do it. You're a man of war. You're a man of bloodshed. But your son will do it. Solomon, his name means peace. Hallelujah. And so what did David do? David stockpiled all of the materials that were necessary to build the temple, and his son built the temple. I hope you hear what I'm saying. Jesus was a man of blood, a man of war. Hallelujah. He stockpiled everything needed, and the Holy Spirit is the one who's building the church. Hallelujah. Amen. The sobering warning we glean from David's biography is that prevention is better than restoration. In other words, while forgiveness is readily available, it doesn't exempt us from reaping what we've sown. What a blessing it is to know. Listen to me closely. There is no sin too big for the blood of Jesus to handle. There's no failure in your life too great for the grace of God to overcome. Somebody get a hold of that tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Here's the thing. While God can redeem, he can restore. Hallelujah. He'd like to help prevent you from getting into some of those messes. Amen. Hallelujah. Say, Lord, help me. Stay out of the ditch. I know you can pull me out of the ditch, but I'd rather stay out of the ditch. Does that make any sense to anybody? Help us all, Lord. Help us all. Praise the Lord. All right, a couple more points here. Let's break it down. What should have happened to David, considering what he did? I know the Bible says he was a man after God's own heart 2 times. I can show it to you in the Bible. But he committed adultery. He had someone murdered. Tried to get Uriah drunk so he would go to his house and sleep with his wife and think the baby was his. And Uriah was a man of integrity and honor and wouldn't do it. And he slept on the palace door step. And so David says, well, that's not working. And he hands him a note, a sealed note to take to Joab, his captain. And it didn't even know it's his own death notice. A message to Joab that put Uriah at the forefront of the battle. And when the battle gets hot, withdraw from him. Leave him unprotected. That's pretty low, folks. Texas folks would say that's lower than a snake's belly. So help me. What should have happened to David? What do you think? He was guilty. How many would agree with me? At the minimum, he should have been removed from being king. How many would agree with that? Could have been. I mean, they didn't stone people for adultery this late, very often. Could have been stoned for adultery. Could have been banished from Israel, from God's presence. Is that what happened to him? That's not fair! You're right. It's grace. That's not fair. It's grace. Help me realize if we got what we deserved, none of us deserve heaven. You mean to tell me one day we're gonna rule and reign with Jesus Christ? One day we're gonna take our crowns and cast them at his feet? One day, hallelujah. We're gonna shout on that crystal sea in the presence of God for all of the ceaseless ages of eternity. That's not fair. I don't deserve that. Oh, thank God for grace. I said, oh, thank God for grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Somebody help me praise him tonight. Hallelujah. David was forgiven. He was restored. He remained king. He was given an everlasting covenant. He was included in the lineage of Christ. And Jesus said one day when Jesus returns, the prophets have said that he will rule as a prince, a kind of a vice president with Jesus Christ in the millennial reign. That's not fair. That's grace. Whew. What a mighty God. You talk about a good, good father. That's who we serve. All right, let's break it down. I'm going to try to wrap this up in a minute. You get anything out of it? Let's read a couple more verses here. We're going to discuss what is forgiveness. Verse 5, he says, I acknowledge my sin to you. 9 months later, better late than never, I guess, right? My iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to you, Lord. And you forgave the iniquity of my sin. For this cause, what cause? For forgiveness. Everyone who is godly shall pray. Not just sinners need forgiveness, saints need forgiveness. Part of Jesus' model prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Look at this next one. In a time when you may be found. I get a little perturbed, amused and perturbed when people say, well, you know, I'll get right with God when he's dealing with me. Or when, no, they say, here's what they say. I'll get right with God when I'm ready. How many have heard that before? What if God's not dealing with you when you're ready? The Bible says, Isaiah 55, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near, while he's wooing you, drawing you, dealing with you. That's the time. Yeah. And here's the other one. Sonny, I know you've heard it. You do a lot of witnessing, a lot of evangelism with people, one-on-one witnessing. But here's the thing. I'm going to get my life all straightened out, and then I'll get saved and start coming to church. Good luck with that. Because you're never going to get your life straightened out without Jesus. He's the one who helped you straighten that life out. Amen? Well, hallelujah. Somebody here don't like me. Is it you? What is forgiveness? Number one, notice in the word forgive, there's the word give. So something is given away, right? Forgive. What is it? To give mercy where judgment is deserved. David deserved judgment, but God gave him mercy instead. Mercy is literally given away in the act of forgiveness. And here's the beautiful thing about God's mercy. There's an infinite supply. Hallelujah. I've searched my Bible. I can't find where the Bible ever says God's anger is new every morning. I can't find a place where the Bible says God's judgment and wrath is new every morning. But I can find a place where the Bible said his mercy is new every morning. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. An infinite supply. Glory to his wonderful name. All right, here's the second thing. All right, what is forgiveness? It means to lift. Everybody say lift. The burden and the guilt of sin. Right here in Psalm 32 where it says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven. It's from a Hebrew word that means to lift. It implies that through forgiveness, the burden, the guilt, the condemnation that follows sin are lifted from the person who repents like a heavy weight being lifted off of their conscience. The heavy burden of shame lifted from David when he finally confessed and repented of his sin. No wonder he broke out into song and rejoiced by penning such a profound psalm. Hallelujah. That is why a person who experiences forgiveness feels light. You feel free. You feel clean. The heavy yoke of separation from God has been lifted and removed. One of my favorite illustrations. How many have read the book A Pilgrim's Progress? Anybody? By John Bunyan. You've read that, Brother Bob, Michelle has, a few of you. I read this book when I was in elementary school. I've never forgotten it. And if you read it in the modern English, because it's called A Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan. It's the original was written in King James language, a little difficult to navigate. But they have a modern English version. Amazon, I'm sure, has got it. John Bunyan was in prison for preaching without a license. They would have released him, but he would not promise that he wouldn't keep preaching. You know, the church had power back then. They controlled everything, the Anglican church. And he said, I'd rather obey God rather than men, basically. He was in prison for 12 years, and his crime was preaching without a license. Boy, we need some more criminals like that, don't we? Help me to be a criminal like that. Well, he sat there for 12 years in prison and wrote one of the greatest books in English literature. In fact, for decades and decades, it was second only to the Bible in sales and distribution. But it's an allegory. It's a story about a man's trek from the world of sin to the celestial city. And the young man's name, appropriately, fittingly, is Christian. He leaves the world of sin behind. He kneels at the cross and he goes through this long, circuitous journey to make it to heaven. And everything about it speaks of what you're dealing with in your daily walk with God. It's a powerful book. They've made it into a movie several times. But here's the scene. Christian's carrying around this heavy backpack. Everywhere he goes, he's burdened down. Heavy weight. And it's sin. Here's the thing. In the book, the moment Christian kneels at the cross, the bands that fasten this backpack to his body are broken. And this heavy backpack goes tumbling down a hill into a grave where it's lost forever. And then he's not stooped over, burdened. Now he's been lifted. He's free. Hallelujah. Somebody say free at last. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now he can walk a lot easier because he's not carrying that guilt, that burden, that condemnation any longer. The burden has been lifted. How many can testify tonight and say, my burden has been lifted. The bands have been broken. Hallelujah. There's no longer a barrier between me and God. I'm free. I've been lifted. Hallelujah. Yes. Praise God. Michelle said, what do you want for your birthday? I said, I want another pair of those shoes you got me 2 years ago, baby. They're called on clouds. Anybody got on clouds? Hallelujah. You feel like they're light as a feather, like you're floating on air. Well, I feel like I'm floating, but it's not because of shoes. Hallelujah. It's because of what Jesus did for me at the cross. He lightened my load. He lifted that heavy burden. Come on, say I've been lifted. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Praise God. Well, I've got a hush, but I'm enjoying myself tonight. Praise God. Didn't preach Sunday. Didn't preach last Wednesday. Had a funeral. Won't preach this Sunday. So I came with both barrels loaded and ready, baby. Hallelujah. Here we go. What does forgiveness mean? It means to forget the cause of offense. The English word forgive is derived from two old English words, forthgive. Here's what it means, to completely dismiss from thought. Completely dismiss from thought. In other words, to forgive is to literally forget. It's not that God can't remember, he simply chooses not to. A person who is granted pardon, let's say you've got a criminal, and the governor says, okay, I'm going to pardon you. They are said to receive amnesty. How many have heard the word amnesty? Get this. It's from a Greek word, amnestia. And it means non-remembrance. So there's literally a link between forgiving and forgetting, not only in the Bible, but also in our language. Praise God. God said, their sins and iniquities, I will remember them no more. Aren't you glad? Isaiah 38:17, thou hast in love to my soul cast all my sins behind thy back. Micah 7:19 says he will cast our sins into the depths of the sea. Revelation 21:1 says there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth and there will be no more sea. So if our sins have been cast in the depths of the sea and there will be no more sea, then what will happen to our sins? Woo, they've been obliterated, annihilated by the blood of Jesus. They do not exist anymore. That's freedom. I said that's freedom. And how many times, not trying to make fun of anybody with a disability, but how many times have we drug ourselves unworthily into the presence of God and said, God, I did it again. How many have done that? I've did it again. And you know what God says? If you were confessed, you were genuine, you repented, you know what God says? Did what again? Did what again? He doesn't remember. He has removed them from his memory bank. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All right, let's wrap this up. I'm preaching myself happy tonight. What is forgiveness? Here's what it means: to remove sin from one's record. David prayed in Psalm 51, 1 and 9, blot out my transgressions. It's indicative of God's power to abolish sin from the record books. To blot means to remove, wipe away, smear out. A blotter was used in Bible times to remove ink smudges from parchment paper. Once blotted, no trace of the smudge could be seen. Forgiveness deletes the splotches of sin from our life's ledger. If we sin, it is placed on our account. When we sincerely repent, God forgives and strikes that sin from the record. Hallelujah. Remission, a forgiveness-related word, also conveys this concept. Among other things, remission denotes the canceling out of sin. How many glad the blood of Jesus has canceled out your past sins, clearing them from the record? Here's the ironic thing. If we try to cover our sins, God will expose them. But if we confess them, God will cover them. What did Adam and Eve do in the Garden of Eden? They found fig leaves. Boy, they started pulling leaves off and stripping vines for thread and found maybe a thorn for a needle. And boy, old Eve became the first seamstress. Made him a little cover. God said, that's not sufficient. Man's been trying to hide his sin since then. And it's not a sufficient covering. So God took the skin of an animal, whether he slayed the animal or the animal was a prey of a predator. We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. But God allowed blood to be shed and he made them coats of skin. He said, I've got a better covering. Are you hearing me tonight? God has a better covering. We try to cover our own sin, but it's insufficient. But God has a better covering. His blood, hallelujah, his grace, his mercy, and his forgiveness. Ooh, hallelujah. I better finish or you won't come back Sunday. Here's the fifth and last thing that forgiveness means: to separate a person from their sin. Praise God. The word remission is a New Testament word. In Romans 4, 7, Paul quotes Psalm 32, 1. And the word that's translated forgiven means to send off, to go away. It implies separation from or departure of one's sin. So forgiveness, both forgiveness and remission, entail a distancing of sin from a person. What did David say in Psalm 103, 12? As far as the east is, let me get my bearings. As far as the what? East is from the west, so far hath God removed our transgressions from us. You'll never face them again unless you turn around and go back to them. Ooh, hallelujah. I want you to think of this, and I'm done. What will heaven be like? Brother Mike has shared this for years, and it's powerful. I love this thought. Heaven will be a place where a man named David, who committed adultery with Uriah's wife and had him killed and covered it up, can walk side by side with Uriah. And David will not feel guilty or ashamed, and Uriah will not feel angry or any desire for revenge. That's what heaven will be like. Only God can do that. I said only God can do that. That's the power of grace. That's the power of forgiveness. Aren't you glad you're a new creature? No wonder David wrote it for us to read. Blessed is the man whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord does not impute sin. He's not going to reckon it to your account. Hallelujah. I'm blessed tonight. You know why? Because I've been forgiven. Will you stand with me, please? Hallelujah. Lord, As we read these words of David, these ancient words, 3,000 years old, we're just standing in awe and wonder at how you moved in his life. And if you move for him, here's what we believe, you'll move for us. And I pray that tonight we'll take a moment to just appreciate the blessing of forgiveness. What a gift. What a gift we receive. Will you lift your hand with me right now and just say, thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. Thank you for lifting the weight, lifting the burden, lifting the guilt, the shame, lifting it. Oh, hallelujah. The condemnation. I'm free tonight because of grace. I don't deserve this, but I thank you for your grace. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We give you praise and glory. God, let us experience it afresh and anew. Your grace. Hallelujah. Will you just thank him right now? Thank you for the Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama, 35502. If we can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey, please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.